So, some people that elephants just don't like, some people elephants do like, and I think it's very much their ability to recognize some kind of energy in you. I don't know how they do it, but I think that does happen, and therefore I would say that they probably can pick up on who you are. Whoop, whoop. You can hear the hoo-poo in the background. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Oh, it is the most gorgeous morning, everyone. It just is so peaceful. And although we haven't found lions all over the place and leopards, it has been the most peaceful morning. Especially as we sit here now with the ultimate in peaceful animals, when they're feeling peaceful, of course, Brian. If they're not, then they're utterly unpeaceful.
Quite terrifying.
Yes, indeed. But to be sitting this distance, probably, well, I don't know, 20 meters, 15 meters or so, 50 feet from an elephant like this is just, I mean, what a privilege. Well, while we do that, Jamie has got a small grey antelope to show you, so let's go and have a look there.
It's very unusual for us to get a really nice Dacre sighting, and this appears to be one such example of one actually quite skinny little grey Dacre. She's not in the best condition. Still managing to eke out a little bit of a living, so to speak, with whatever shoots and leaves she can find. Usually we see a dacre disappearing off. We see their backsides as they bounce off into the direction of the bush. But this little one is a bit more relaxed around vehicles. And she's a female, she doesn't have any horns, but she does have that lovely mohawk. In this case, it looks more like a top ponytail sticking out the top of her head. Oh my goodness, Sandy, you gave me such a fright. I had my radio turned up far too loud. I got such a fright. Sorry. I was leaning down like this to look into the monitor. Okay, I don't know why that gave me such a fright. I think it was just the explosion of sound next to my ear. But it's alright, we're all under control. The Dacre's disappeared, as they do. Whew! Right. I'm going to wait for my heart rate to recover. I don't quite know why I had such a dramatic and violent reaction to that sound, but I did. While we've been driving along, I remain convinced that I smelt leopard urine on the corner where we went through towards Nyala Road South. Jandre can't smell it, but that's because Jandre says he might have a slightly blocked nose. I'm sure I can smell it. But I cannot, the bizarre thing is I cannot find a single track. Since the ones I saw on Batalia heading in that direction that would give me any indication that a leopard walked past there at all. So I'm starting to feel as though I'm going slightly mad. Now a leopard has a very, very distinctive, or the smell of leopard urine has a very distinctive scent. It is meant to smell like buttered popcorn. I've always disagreed with that, but I have to say over the last few weeks I'm starting to, I don't know whether something switched in my brain and I'm associating that smell with buttered popcorn more and more. It is starting to smell like buttered popcorn. Seems like a bizarre thing to reference, but that is what it is. Like, I swear I smell a leopard, but if it's in Chila, she might be doing the same thing that she did to James the other day, which is get up and run and then relax and sit down. And I was chatting to Tristan yesterday. He said that she's always done that. When you see her, she gets up and sprints away, and then you give her a few moments, and then she settles down. And it's not that she's not relaxed, it's just her personality, it's just her way of things. She's not afraid of vehicles, she just has a way of reacting to them that's slightly different to the leopards that we get to see on a regular basis. Speaking of which, on the subject of our spotted cats, Tingana, Shadow and Karula are all together once again in the same sighting. So similar to what we experienced the other day, Tingana is still mating with Shadow, and Karula's wandering along growling and salivating and being just generally annoyed with the whole situation. Now they may well be, sounds like, on their way towards Juma, which is exciting for either this morning or this afternoon. And on the subject of our big cats and the different personalities, we've got a question about the different leopard and lion skin tones or fur tones. And Desiree in Colorado, lovely to have you on board, a newer viewer for us, or a name that I haven't heard at least. I think you're a newish viewer. Now, you wanted to know about whether or not there are any white lions in the area or strawberry leopards. So the strawberry leopards, similar to the leucistic style of the white lions. You are correct. There was a strawberry leopard recorded in South Africa. Of course, Tara Puri, who used to work for Wild Earth, did an amazing article on... That's very, very pretty. Sorry, I will get back to that question in a moment, but that's too pretty to ignore. How beautiful is that? The shimmer of a green wood hoopoe. Sifting through the bark of this acacia tree and managing to find probably termites and other things underneath it. Using that incredibly sensitive bill to probe underneath and then catch whatever happens to be unlucky. Oh, this is really awesome. See a beautiful view of the white spots underneath the tail and that amazing iridescent sheen of the feathers. Now, this is a bird that is completely black in those places, and that sheen is created by reflection and refraction of light by the overlays of the keratin in the feathers. Stunning. Absolutely beautiful. Worth a little bit of a distraction from the question on strawberry leopards. So, strawberry leopards, there was one around Leidenburg. There was also a melanistic leopard heard of around Leidenburg. They're around. We just don't see them very often. I mean, we don't... It's unusual. It's a rare genetic abnormality. So we don't see them that frequent. I've never seen one. But they are definitely around and about. In this area, probably not. We'd probably know about it if they were, but that being said, a leopard can move hundreds of kilometers, particularly if it is a male. So the fact that there isn't one here today doesn't mean that there couldn't be one tomorrow. And the same applies for the white lion gene. As I'm sure you know, most of the white lions a large percentage of the white lion genetics comes from a place called the Timbavati. And of course, we are connected to the Timbavati. It's all open. There's no fences between us and them. I see it. I still see it. Can you see it there on the bush? Well done. Well, we're having a bird morning this morning, unintentionally. Well done, Jandre. He's there on that curve. Well done. Awesome. Another kingfisher to add to your list, I think also brown-hooded. That was the one that you had with James, wasn't it? Brown-hooded? Yeah. This is also a brown-hooded kingfisher. The birds are keeping us from answering our question on white lions this morning. But another beautiful little bird. Well spotted, Jandre. Jandre's on form. It must have been the stubbed toe that's keeping him going. I was going to finish that story. I will in a moment. But let's go back to the white lions. The white lion genetics occasionally pop out elsewhere. So the Lubombo Mountains all the way on the other side of Kruger National Park, all of a sudden one of their lion prides had a white lion cub. So it is possible. It's rare, but it is possible. Can you imagine if the Nkuhumas, if one day Amber Eyes had a white lion cub? Can you imagine? And then be mass celebration. as we trundle along, I'm going to make my way towards the southern boundary in the hope that perhaps the leopards decide to pop out. I'm going to send you back over to James and his lovely elephants. However, be warned, he is busy doing a VR segment. In other words, that virtual reality ball. He'll explain that more when he's done. So if he's ignoring your questions, it's not because he's ignoring you or that he doesn't like you at all. It's just that he's busy doing a VR segment. So go and have a look at his ellies.
And here he comes. He might take a few more steps closer towards us. And just all around, we can hear the call of elephant behind him. So if you look towards him and behind him, we can hear another herd of elephants calling. And then to the right-hand side, we can hear them calling. They make that very deep-throated sound, and most of it inaudible to the human ear. And this young bull just trying to keep his distance from the rest of the herd, because he's now probably about, I'd say maybe 15 years old. And that means that he's come to a time of his life, well, when he just doesn't want to be too much around the mums and youngsters, in exactly the same way as a 15-year-old human being starts to distance himself slightly from his parents and younger siblings. He's a cool cat, you see, eating on his splendid thorn tree on the Monday morning. And all around us, the birds of the new spring are starting to call. Got a hoopoe going boop, boop, boop. A white-browed scrub robin going. It's all rather peaceful. There you can see now, if you look straight towards him, you can, and his trunk, you can see A, the dexterity of it, and B, the fact that he's actually eating wood. Now, I don't know what you can see from where you're sitting there, but maybe you can see over the top of his head onto his back, and you can see his shoulders sticking out. And if you look around him, you can see his hips sticking out. This is a function of the drought that we've been having. So it hasn't been a very easy time for elephants, especially because they have to eat so much. Big bull, 300 kilograms a day. Young bull like this, probably about 150 kilograms of food a day. That's almost, just over 300 pounds of food in one day. And during a drought, they're going to struggle to find enough to eat. And you may have heard, just in the distance, a screaming sound. It's another young elephant within another herd. That's got cross, throwing a bit of a tantrum. And just keep glancing up to the sky every so often and see if you don't spot a vulture flying overhead. It's just starting to warm up now, and that means that the vultures and the eagles will start to use the thermals to rise up and fly into the sky. Now he's turning back to this hapless, splendid thorn tree where he's going to continue his breakfast. Okay, everybody, we're back. We're turning off the VR rig. We kind of hoped he might come a little bit closer, but there it is. He did give us one or two little shouts while you were away, looking at the green wood hoopoe with Jamie and the diker. But now he's calmed down again and is eating his splendid thorn tree. And incredibly skillfully, well, not, that's not so incredibly skillful, that's just his tail. But he's, I'll show you what I mean now once we've seen it. He's quite incredibly skillfully tucking the branches between his tusks and his trunk, and he wedges them there, and that's how he breaks off some of the thicker ones. But like I say, I have seen elephants in much better nick than this, I must say. Justin, you're interested in how complex of a puzzle an elephant could solve. I think were you to give him a fairly advanced geometrical problem, he could probably use the Euclid to solve it. No, Justin, I don't know. It's an impossible question to answer. I mean, we know that elephants paint, for example. If you give them paint, some of them will actually pick up a brush and paint on canvas. That is in captivity, though. But I think that their problem-solving ability is probably very good, and that's because of the problem that they need to solve when it comes to getting enough to eat and finding water to drink and looking after kids. And their complicated social structure indicates that they would be relatively good at problem solving. Would they be as good as, say, a gorilla or a chimpanzee? No, I don't think they would be. But they have a different kind of intelligence, I suppose. But I'm not sure that they would be able to solve particularly complex puzzles. That's an interesting one. I mean, we know that rats, for example, will learn a maze very quickly. You can remove half the brain of a rat. You read these horrible experiments that they've done, and you can take out everything but the brain stem, basically, and a rat will still learn to find food through a maze. Now, I imagine an elephant with its fairly vast brain is probably equally adept as that. So maybe they would sort things like mazes out. I don't know that you could ever teach one to calculate something like you can with some of the other primates. I think you can teach a chimpanzee to count to 4 or 5, if I'm not mistaken. Brian is nodding at me, he says yes. But I don't know that you could teach an elephant to count to 4 or 5. But also, you know, the closer we get to something like a primate, like an enormous, like a chimpanzee or a gorilla, the larger our ability is to communicate with them on a sort of similar level, because they communicate with facial expressions, they communicate by looking into each other's eyes, and they pick up many of the same signals that we as human beings pick up from each other. Now, when you look at an elephant's facial structure is completely different, and so to be able to pick up an emotion from an elephant's face is impossible, in the same way that it's impossible to pick up an emotion from an impala's face, because it just doesn't have the musculature to show you how it feels. And so I think because of that, it's much easier to discover, for example, how capable a primate is at solving a problem than it is to discover how good an elephant is at solving a problem. Now, Louise has spotted a snake skin on this tree behind the Ellie's trunk. Do you see it there, Brian?
Not currently.
It could well be there. I don't see it currently either. Louise, shout if you see it again. Quite interesting. Jamie's just said that there's a report of Karula, Tingana and Shadow heading north towards Vuyatela, which is quite nice. So they might actually come onto Juma. We're not too far from that particular area, but let's find out from Jamie. Right, there's the snake skin, apparently just to the left of his tusk. Ah, well spotted, Louise. Now, that could easily be a boomslang or tree snake. And I say that because of the shape. And what they do is they climb onto these trees and they hook the nose or the nasal scales onto a thorn, and then they wriggle out of their old skin, and then off they go to terrorize the world. Now, I'm obviously being facetious. Snakes are not very terrifying. All right, let's leave this fellow to his breakfast, I think, and move on and see what else we can see. What do you say, Brian?
Yes,
I think it's a good idea. We've had a lovely time with him. He's been very confiding. Don't get upset. Come on now. He's just saying, why are you making a noise now? You're disturbing me. Go away. And we're saying, no problem. We will go away. And there's the rest of the herd. totally, totally relaxed around us, which is just the best. I'm just going to find out from Jamie where she is so that we don't sort of double up and go in the same places. Jamie, do you copy? Jamie? I think she's on the other channel trying to find out what's going on with those leopards. Anyway, we'll go down towards Twin Dams, have a look and see around there. So I don't know where these lions have gone. There are elephants all over the place here. I've just seen Rexon come down this road. So I don't think there are any lion tracks around here, but let's see what else we can find on this very soporific, peaceful morning on the 5th of spring. Hello, Debbie, you say with the warmer weather on its way, when are we going to start seeing more snakes and tarantulas? Well, Debbie, we could probably start seeing tarantulas, aka baboon spiders, fairly soon. They are around, and I think they just close up shop during the winter time, but you can find them in the winter, and we did see a few of them in the winter. Snakes, around about now, you know, it started to warm up. They also need water, and so it's basically after the first rains that things like snakes are going to start spending more time out. But we don't see a lot of snakes here. You know, I have not seen many snakes since I've been here, and that's not to say that they're not around. There are plenty of them around. They just tend to avoid noisy things like the cars, and they avoid us when we're walking. But I have seen the odd snake. But it is much more likely, as you say, during the summer months to see a snake than it is during the winter. We're heading towards Twin Dams now. Not Twin Dams. Oh, there's a giraffe. I meant Treehouse Dam. Oh, sorry, Brian. Just ease our way around the corner here and say hello to the Rafi. Eating tambuti tree, interestingly, very toxic to the human being. How's that, Brian? Look, delicious tambuti tree, full of toxic latex. That is not good for people. It's okay for giraffes, very good for black rhino. Just taking the jersey off, Brian. It's getting a bit warm. And also eaten astonishingly at the base by porcupines. They love the tambuti tree. So nice. And he's standing on a slope, you know, and a giraffe is vulnerable on a slope like that because they're not particularly, they're not that agile. And because they're quite top heavy for obvious reasons, if a lion is ever chasing a giraffe, because they're quite difficult to kill, they will try and herd them towards a drainage line like this, because if a giraffe has to run down and through a drainage line like this, it's very often that they'll fall over and break something, and then the lions can get at them. Ah, well, far from just going to find out about the leopards, she's actually found them. Let's go and look.
We have indeed, with help from some of the Chitwa guides, we once again find ourselves in the incredible position where we have three leopards in one sighting. In this case, Tingana, Shadow and Karula. That being said, I have absolutely no idea where Karula is. I've been told that she is here. I'm relatively certain that that is Shadow, and that Tingana's just off to the left there, for those of you that are keen-eyed. Karula apparently was just here somewhere, but I can't see her anywhere in the vicinity. Are we going to start talking about this amazing sighting in 1 second? I do, however, need the opportunity to just call it in on the Northern Game Drive channel and just get some people moving in. It does look like they're going to start coming across towards our direction. The reason why we can't reposition is because this is Little Gowrie. So we cannot go onto this particular property. We have to wait for them to come to us. Oh, amazing times. Obviously, Karula's decided that she's going to keep a very, very close and watchful eye on these two. I suspect she's been following them around more than it's the other way around. So whenever Tingana basically will go wherever he wants to go. Shadow, as the female in Estrus, will follow along with him. And Karula, because this is in her territory, is just seriously unimpressed by the whole deal. So she's on the outskirts, hanging around, kind of better the danger you see than the danger you don't, although neither of them are particularly risky for her in terms of being in her territory. It's just the fact that Tingana has brought another lady into her home. Even if it is her daughter, she's not terribly impressed with it. So that's why we've still got all three of them together. I just don't know where the third is. And Shamsun, I'm afraid not as much as we would like to think of it as a family reunion with the cubs. I think Karula's purely following these two around because she's cross. She's cross about the fact that her daughter is in her territory. I don't think we have any reunion scenes planned with Auntie Shadow, or would she be Auntie? Hold on. Family tree. Staying with us. I'm not quite sure exactly what's going on. Hold on one moment. We've got visual of these three Ingwe from Gowrie Main, just maybe 100 meters west of Weaver's Nest Junction. It's just myself here. You're welcome to make your way.
Confirm I can make my way that side.
That's affirmative. They're still on the southern side of the road, but there's clear visual of at least two of them.
Okay, thanks. No,
I think we missed all of them.
Okay,
I'll see you now. Copy. Okay, sorry everybody about that. Minor confusion there, but we are all under control. I've managed to call Tex in. I'm going to ask him to manage this sighting so that we can chat a little bit more about these particular leopards and what's going on here. So no family reunions. Shadow is... she is the aunt, right? No. She's their sister. She's their sister. She's their half-sister. Gosh, leopards... leopards are terribly confusing to me. Terribly, terribly confusing. That explains it. So we had some minor confusion there with Lou telling me that she's their sister, but for some reason I heard that as quick link. Chandra, I don't know what you heard. Anyway, I thought James had something terribly exciting he wanted to show you. So she's their sister, but it's not impossible. We have heard of situations and have seen situations where a female is feeding her cubs and she's got an older sibling with her that is then sharing the kill. The difficulty is, of course, that Shadow, as far as we know, as far as we knew, is the mother of a cub that is just a month younger than Karula's. As for what's happened to her poor little cub, we really don't know. It's not looking very positive at this stage. Obviously, Shadow's got something physical about her that makes her body go into estrus on or slightly earlier basis than she might otherwise. I'm going to just try and go forward a little bit. I think it might improve our view of Tingana, and it gives me a chance to look for wherever Karula may be, unless she's crossed. She's not crossed behind me. That did not help at all. Sort of got a view of Tingana. I'll stop so you can see him quickly. I don't know, that's probably about as good as it's going to get. Now, of course, everybody was terribly concerned about Karula's cubs during that incredible sighting with hyenas and wild dogs and Tingana in the smallest marula tree in the world, or the thinnest marula tree in the world. Smiley, we know that the next day Herbert tracked her and Karula and her two cubs south, so she moved them. Probably, I mean, Karula knows what she's doing. She knew to move them away before she decided to return to this situation. Now she moved them off somewhere to the safe, and she's now just following along behind with Shadow and Tingana, just generally unimpressed with life. And for now, I think this has probably been the situation over the last 2 days, but there seems to be something of a stalemate. Shadow and Tingana are apparently mating, so that's something that we might see in the next few moments. As you know, leopard mating is a relatively regular experience. Every couple of minutes or so, depending on the temperature of the day, and today is not particularly warm, but for now, Shadow's just taking the opportunity to groom herself. I feel quite sorry for Shadow. She seems to have had a very stressful few days. The last time we saw her, she'd been chased up a tree by hyenas, and to call it a tree would be to exaggerate slightly. It wasn't so much a tree as a twig. Tingana managed to get himself up a beautiful marula tree, nice, big, comfortable spot, but poor Shadow had to make do elsewhere. And then she was pacing around at the bottom of the marula tree, looking longingly up at Tingana, waiting for him to come down and pay some attention to her. Oh, Mike, you can make your way.
I'll the second, you're the third text.
One of the things that we do, of course, as you know, which is collect data, collect leopard scat in order to pass on the DNA data to Panthera. And Shamsun knows, as far as I know, the scat will not contain any hormonal clues that might provide us with evidence as to why it is that Shadow seems to go into estrus so quickly. And there's nothing really physically wrong with her. It just her body goes into estrus a little bit sooner. The reason I say that is hormones, as basically proteins, are going to break down almost immediately. You need some really seriously fresh scat to be brushed off to be tested before you'll be able to determine whether or not there's any hormonal imbalance. So I don't think we're looking at a hormonal imbalance. It just happens slightly faster. So no, that's not something, and it's also something that would be incredibly costly to do. Be interesting in terms of scientific research and scientific information, but there's nothing that anybody could do in order to correct it or sort it out. Amazing, the flexibility of leopards. Look at her reaching back between her shoulder blades there. Oh, what was that? Here we go again. Spot. And there we go. The whole very noisy mating leopard process. Oh, see that snarl. Generally, the females have tremendous aggression during this time of their lives, and the males as well. It's because, the male's penis is barbed, so that whole process is terribly uncomfortable for her. And it means that she turns around and attempts to bat him. He bites her on the back of the neck to stop her from hurting him during the whole process, but then as soon as he goes to dismount, then she turns around and swats him, which she couldn't really do in that particular scenario because... Whoa! She's still growling at him. She couldn't really turn around and hit him in this particular situation because there were branches in the way. And we are going to have to give up our view at some point. We've probably got the best of the views at the moment, but at some point we'll have to shift around so that Tax could come and his guests can see them. They've unfortunately just popped themselves in the worst possible position. So we might have to do some shifting around in a moment. So while we do, let's go across to James for a quick update on his side. Tex, come take my place. I'll shift for you.
There was a diker there, everybody. We've come on where we found now some lion tracks, some new ones. I don't know how fresh they are. They look a little bit windswept to me, but I don't know that anyone's driven down this road yet. So they could have come back into this area. We might just bump into them down the road here. And that would be very nice, wouldn't it, Brian? Yes. What we'll see. There's a lovely leafy glade just through here. Resting place? Well, I think that's what I'd choose, really. Should be something in there, in the leafy glade. Here it is. We're arriving at the leafy glade, Brian. Quite a turn up for the books, the three leopards pitched up. Very nice. Now what we're going to do is just stop and have a listen here and see if we can't hear the lion cubs. I haven't got their tracks anymore, which means I think they've probably gone in off to the right hand side there. Whether they've remained there or not, I don't know. That's quite rough. I think you'd find that the older ones could probably walk almost as far as the adults could. Now, I don't know, say 4 or 5 kilometers in the night. Can you hear something, Brian?
But I didn't.
But the smaller ones, maybe just 2 or so kilometers. Okay, Karula is coming into Vuyatela. Let's go have a look.
Beautiful shot of Fanwell, Taxon's amazing tracker, and the Queen of Juma. And by the way, welcome back on board the Jerry Springer Show, which is exactly what Jandre and I have just been discussing. With Karula watching her daughter mate with the current father of her cubs. Keep track of all of that. There's a certain complication within the leopard world. There's all kinds of things that happen. They, of course, are not guided by the same code of conduct that we are, much like the people on the Jerry Springer Show, I imagine. But it is quite... Oh, she's actually going. Karula's actually moving off now. She might come back, but she might also have decided that it's time for her to let this whole situation lie and go and sort out her young cubs. Good girl. She's slowly disappearing into... Well, she's not disappearing, she's walking parallel along Gowrie Main. So she's probably feeling a little bit hungry. She, of course, lost her impala kill to Tingana, as if the scenes couldn't get any more dramatic than they already were. She lost her impala kill to Tingana. which meant that she didn't really get to eat her fill, and neither did her cubs. And whilst she's moved them away to safety, at some point she's got to go and find them some food as well. And I think that is her plan now. So we arrived at the perfect time because the Queen is on her way. And as she slowly melts into the vegetation, Lady Lone Wolf... No, she's not a danger to... Most likely not a danger to Karula's cubs. She's related to Karula. It's quite unusual. Sometimes female leopards do kill the cubs of other female leopards, but usually not in a situation where it's a mother-daughter or a related relationship in some way. It does occasionally happen, but it's very, very unusual. So chances are that no, Shadow is not a threat to Karula's cubs. I don't think she'd do them any harm. I also think that that's awesome. What a beautiful view. I think that Shadow is weaker than Karula, personally. I think that Karula's actually a little bit stockier than her daughter, and one of the reasons why she's more successful in terms of hoisting her kills. And I think that Karula would be more than capable of protecting those cubs. And the first thing we noticed, there's the characteristic Karula tail twitch. The first thing we noticed when Shadow and Tingana came into the sighting was when Shadow started walking in the direction of Karula's cubs, she immediately headed her off and actually ended up chasing her a little way away. I don't think Shadow is a really major threat to Karula's royal babies, to her younger siblings actually, her younger half-siblings. No wonder I keep getting so confused. It's very complicated. All we need is the unveiling of the Panthera DNA paternity results and we'll have a full-on soap opera. When, shock and horror, it turns out that Tingana is not the father. He will probably be, of course. There's a very good chance that he is. A really lovely view of the Queen in the morning sunlight. Come on, girl, come north. Come hunt north. I wonder if she feels pressurized by her daughter, Nchila. The Queen's enormous home range is slowly shrinking. Off she goes. Well done, Jandre. Awesome. She's not really playing ball though, is she? She's just a little bit too far. Come on, girl. Come this way. She goes. She's going deeper into Chitwa. Oh, sorry, not Chitwa, Little Gowrie. I'm just going to gently nudge Mike's vehicle. Oh, there's a Daker. There's a Daker. I don't think it's realized she's there. Let me go forward a little bit. Just wait. I can't move now. She's hunting. There's the Daker coming into the road. She's hunting. She's stalking a Daker. She's gone completely flat. I can't even see her. There goes the Daker. sure. I think it's gone that little bit too far from her. I don't think that taker realizes just how close it came. I've lost visual of both of them now. Just yet. We know that she's stalking somewhere here. Let's see if you can spot her. When it happens, if it happens, it's going to happen unbelievably quickly. There she is. She's up. She's given up. There she goes. I don't think that daycare even knew she was there. I don't even know where she popped up from there. Not a clue. That's incredible. She went completely flat. It's amazing. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. So she went completely flat down onto her belly there. As that Dacre walked past, it just picked a good, well, the worst line for her, the best line for it, because it must have moved just that little bit away from where she was, and she didn't quite have that element of surprise. She's stalking again, or is she moving? Chosen to stay with Karula just because she is on the move. The other two are going to be sort of sleeping back there for a while. They might decide to cross. But let's stick with her for now. She's clearly on the hunt. Oh, that was so close. That Dacre, if it had just walked maybe 10 meters slightly. Oh, there she goes. Maybe 10 meters difference to where it walked, and you would have seen it and she would have caught it. And just bear with me one moment. Do you mind if I nip ahead? Thank you. Thanks, Mike. Here she goes. She's moving fast now. Unfortunately, on our southern boundary, I can see her through this gap. She should pop out. I could see her through this gap. Now I can't see anything. I think that might be the end of our Queen Karula sighting. While I attempt to find her once again, let's jump back onto board with James and find out what he's up to.
I feel slightly like we're on Groundhog Day here, everyone. Every time you come back here, I've got nothing really to tell you that is new. At least you've had Karula, the Great Queen. We've come past here. I've now searched absolutely every single road that I can in this section of Juma. And so, well, bar one more, which we're going to go down now. I don't know where these lions are. I think they're probably in the thick block. I'm not going to worry about them anymore. They don't want to see me or Brian. Do they, Brian?
No, they don't.
No. Now let's link back to Karula.
Okay, well, I was just trying to take an opportunity quickly to be on the Game Drive channel. The Queen has disappeared. So bear with me one moment. I'm sorry. I just need to carry on this conversation. Look to your left. The Mufaz on her way that side. Otherwise, you're welcome to make your way into the other two, which Texans a little bit further west with them. Sorry, everybody. Just helping to direct vehicles into the sighting. I can't see her now, I've lost her. Where did you go, girl? Hi, guys. Where did she go? Okay, we are pulling out of the Shadow and Tingana sighting since there are other vehicles. I'm not sure where the mic has gone. Oh, goodness gracious. Lots of conversations happening now on the game drive comms. I've lost her, Jean-André. I can't see her. I think she might have gone into that drainage line.
Okay, if he's in front of you, on the top of the bank there, there's that tree there. Just
where did you go? Oh, there's a stem book. I wonder if she spotted that. I don't think so. I think we're a little bit further ahead of her. But the stem book is on alert. I think it might have heard something, but it doesn't realize that she's around that area. Gone back to nibbling away. Little Steambook, you don't realize how precarious your position is right now. This is a very difficult situation because I don't know exactly where Karula is, and I don't know whether or not she has spotted this little bite-sized meal. Little female Steambook, very much on alert. The wind is starting to swirl, which is of immediate advantage to Karula and to the Steenbok's disadvantage as she starts to sneak up. If indeed she is sneaking up, I can't tell because I don't know where exactly she is. Alan for Jamie. Sorry everybody, I do have to try and control the sighting as well.
Almost a spot where the bomber that in Yaru on the eastern side of the Danish line. And on the eastern side of the Ari cut line itself.
Never mind, I give up.
Copy that. Just, what's the best approach?
And James has just heard from Rexon that the Lion Cubs are actually not far away from where they were with that buffalo kill not too long ago. So that's what the conversation is about at the moment. Little Steenbok nibbling away, all innocent. I'm gonna reposition. I'm going to go backwards because I'm not 100% sure. We could sit here for the next 10 years. Not quite. That's an exaggeration. We could sit here for ages and it'll turn out that Karula's gone in completely the opposite direction. Now we're far enough away that we can reposition without... Oh, I think he spotted her. She's just dashed off. Just double check. Steenbok hasn't gone too far away. We saw how flat she went earlier, you know how difficult it will be to spot her. Now that we can't go follow in off-road. I don't know where she's gone. I think she's gone further in. I honestly do. I think that she's gone further into Little Gowrie, moving along the safety of this dip, or that drainage line. And Shamsun's absolutely right. It would be amazing if Karula were to jump out of the bushes all of a sudden and grab the stembok. It would actually be quite sad in a way, because we spent so long watching that little stembok nibble away innocently. But the queen is looking very hungry, and we know that she has two other little mouths to feed. And I think today was that stembok's lucky day. I think it just happened to be on the right side of the crest. I don't think Karula would have seen it from that angle that she was walking at. And we wanted to make the kill on this side. Well, I mean, obviously we wanted to make a kill wherever she is able to. But ideally, if it could be on this side of the road, that would be lovely. And a very good point from Lou, that if Karula had managed to steal that stembok or that daka, catch that stembok or daka, then there's a very good chance that Tingana would have stolen it, since he is so close to this vicinity. Very valid point. That is probably exactly what would have happened. Tingana would have come along and done exactly what he did to her with the impala carcass, unless she got lucky and he didn't manage to smell it and he moved off in an opposite direction. If he didn't stay with Karula, if he moved in a different direction, she might have got lucky. But I think ideally she needs to go and hunt a little bit further afield, away from him. Tax, tax.
Go ahead.
Is it just the two vehicles there?
There's three vehicles now. They will have joined.
Copy that, no problem. I'm going to be pulling out of the sighting. Karula's gone further to the south.
Yeah, also, she went more west, and Tingana is just walking around trying to find her. Most of
you. Okay, copy. Thanks very much. I'm going to be pulling out. Alrighty, guys, there are three vehicles in that particular sighting, so we're going to be moving out and leaving them to do their thing. It seems as though Shadow is moving south of the boundary, so she's moving off a little bit further, and she's probably, unfortunately, going to be leading Tingana in the wrong direction as well. So keep on moving, pushing further and further to the south. We need them to come north, just that little bit further to the north. The wind is starting to pick up, which is good news for the Queen Karula as she goes about hunting. It'll definitely work to her advantage, and it'll also potentially work in terms of blowing the scent of the kill away from wherever Tingana happens to be. The fact that Shadow Shingana, mixing up all the words now, mixing up all the names, the fact that Shadow is moving west with Tingana is good. It means that Karula will finally have some peace and be able to move off a little bit. Now, I do know Karula relatively well, and there's a good chance that she's going to go south for a little bit before she decides to pop back north again. She's one of the most unpredictable leopards in terms of her movements. And what I might do is just, I think now is an appropriate time to use the word lurk. I'm going to lurk around the southern boundary. Unfortunately, I'm not hearing names coming through very clearly at the moment. I don't know why my radio is a little bit muffly. But Selena, there we go. Selena, welcome to the Sunrise Safari. I hope you enjoyed that sighting of those leopards. A truly magical experience to be able to see three leopards in one different sighting. The answer to your question about what Karula does when she makes a kill with her cubs is she stashes the kill And if she can, she'll put it in a tree, obviously, because that's the safest possible spot for it. So she will stash her kill and she will go and fetch the cubs and take them to it. And that applies across the board from their first few weeks and months of life right up until they are almost at the stage of independence. Sometimes towards the later months of their, when they're over a year old, they might be with her while she's hunting. But for the most part, she leaves them, she goes and she hunts, and then she goes and fetches them. It's one of the reasons why we get so excited when you see a female leopard with one set of tracks going one way and then going back with cubs. You immediately know that there's something exciting there, since they tend to, from what we've observed, they actually tend to walk pretty much a direct straight line, or on the roads at least, which means that they usually follow exactly the same pathway, so you can figure out exactly what's going on there. So Karula will go and make a kill, preferably here if she would be so kind, but wherever she manages to catch something, and then she'll go and she'll fetch her little cubs. The plan is just to do a little bit of a loop and then come back to the southern boundary and see whether she doesn't pop out close to perhaps Twin Dams or one of her other favorite areas in that side. What it does tell me is that whichever leopard I was tracking this morning was not Karula, Shadow, or Tingana. Well, I knew it wasn't Tingana, but it was not Shadow or Karula. The next one, of course, on the list that we've got to see is Tundi and her brand new cubs. So Tundi is the twin sister of Shadow, and she's got a very, very young set of little leopard cubs, so that's something that we're excited about seeing as well. Hello, boy. Aren't you beautiful? Standing tall on the opposite side of a drainage line wall. Beautiful old male. I recognize this particular guy just by that balding patch around his neck where the ox pickers have been picking away at his sensitive skin. And his slightly skew ossicones, though the horns on the top of his head. A magnificent male giraffe. And as he stares pensively off into the distance, I have wonderful news. Mr. Henry has done it once again and managed to find you some gorgeous bundles of joy for your morning safari.
Absolutely nothing to do with me, everybody. This was purely the brilliance of Rexon, who first found you the three leopards, and then he found the lions. So that's very useful of him. Herbert has been, he's on leave now, and so Rexon is helping us out, and he's doing a fantastic, fantastic job. Isn't this great? It really isn't far from where they were found yesterday. So I suspect what the adults did was they walked around in the night and they left their tracks all over the place, but they probably left the youngsters right here. She's had enough of the youngsters trying to feed. They get very cross when they want to eat and they're not allowed to. I think what's interesting with these lion cubs is that they do get very fat when they're little, you know. But once they start to get to the age where they are going to think about, well, they're not going to think about it, but where they have to start eating meat, I think the milk production from the mothers goes down a bit. And they can start to look a bit scraggly, a little bit like a teenager that's kind of had a growth spurt and not quite filled out yet. I'm just going to move slightly. Ach no, let's wait here for now. He's doing such a nice performance for us. Excellent performance, Brian.
Mm.
Yes. The roly-poly, I think it's called. very sweet. Very good question from Joan. Joan, you say, when the female lion cubs, so the little lionesses, become adults and fully functioning members of the pride, will there be any dominance from the older ones towards them, or will there be some kind of protectionism? Joan, dominance and lion hierarchy tends to function purely on the basis of size. So, no, once the youngsters get big enough to compete at a kill site, for example, then there will be no dominance. It will be purely dependent on size, in the same way that it is right now. I think we often mistake Amber Eyes for some kind of leader or dominant lioness in this pride because she's just obviously so distinctive. I don't think she's any bigger. She might be slightly bigger than some of the others. And there's a little teddy bear lion cub. It's too sweet. Look. These are the best ones, I think, at the moment. The smallest ones. They're so fat. In a very healthy kind of a way. They remind me of my nephew William when he was a youngster. He was a fat, healthy little boy. And every time I see these chaps, I do hope he and his mother are not watching. Every time I look at these chaps, I think of him. Just could not be more content if it tried, could it? And the desire, of course, to get out, walk over there and pick it up and squeeze it, cuddle a tiny little thing like that is enormous, until, of course, Brian pans slightly to the left. You realize that were you to get out of the car and go and try and cuddle that thing, you'd be faced with that. That would not be fun, would it, Brian?
No. Not cuddly either.
Not cuddly, not fun, many sharp points.
Although she would try and cuddle you.
She would, yes. Yes. You see, she agrees. You want a cuddle? And they are going to settle in for a hard sleep now, I think. Kadria, you're wondering if the Rexon I've just mentioned is your Rexon from the earlier days. I think it is. I think it is the very same. So he is back in the house, as it were. Which is very nice for us, especially. There, that's that. Remember, every time I stopped to listen today, that's what I was hoping to hear. And Leventia, you're wondering at what age the male cubs start to look bigger than the females. Leventia, I think you'll find at about a year it'll be pretty obvious. And maybe a bit before that. I'm just thinking, I mean, I didn't think it happened as early as it does with leopards, but Shongile seems to be noticeably smaller than Hosanna these days. And they are now 6 months old, so they're older than these chaps. 7 months old, sorry. And so I think you'll find with lions, which do get slightly bigger, by the time they're 7 or 8 months old, it probably will be a slight difference, but by the time they're a year old, it will become very obvious. And that's as puberty starts to happen. Oh, it's just too wonderful, this. The little teddy bear can't get comfortable. It keeps waking up. It must be a wonderful life as a lion cub when there isn't some sort of pride takeover going on or coalition takeover. because you just get to lie in that kind of sweet repose, completely oblivious to the trials and tribulations of life. Your little pads open to the sun, breathing completely at peace, sleeping on a bed of fur that is your very own. Isn't that just too gorgeous? Hello, easy peasy, as we watch that lion cub seemingly without a care in its world. You want to know if they are in any danger from predators. They would be, but for the fact that the adults are here. So when they left them last night, and I'm pretty sure they did leave them last night, then they would have been in danger from animals like hyenas and leopards. You're absolutely correct. Hyenas and leopards could do some serious damage here, and would, if they came across the cubs without the adults here, then they would almost certainly kill them. But that didn't happen, and so everyone is fine. Right now, there is nothing that would come here and threaten these cubs, except a marauding band of new males. But even they would think twice about attacking a group of five lionesses. So while the adults are here, they're very, very safe. There's just a low rumbling growl coming from one of the mothers. Yeah, Susan, it's a good question. You say, how do you identify the difference between two lionesses? You say, is it facial markings or a sort of combination? It's definitely a combination. Susan, amber eyes, for example, is extremely easy to identify because she has amber eyes. But the others, not so easy. They're of different ages, and so the oldest lioness has got a blunt, I think it's a bottom right canine. She's got a fairly blunt bottom right canine, so that's pretty obvious. And she's got a totally black nose. But the others, it is pretty much scars. You can do it from the spots, the whisker spot pattern above the sort of last line of whiskers. But unless you've got them, you know, unless you've got sort of 5 minutes to count those spots, it's almost impossible. So yes, it's shape of the face, facial markings, nicks in the ear, blunted teeth, and a general sort of impression, I suppose. One of them got a very long face. That little thing is so deeply satisfied with its life, isn't it, Brian?
Mm.
Which it deserves, of course, because life is not easy for a little lion like this once they get a little bit older. There's only a 1 in 10 chance that if that's one of the males, it will survive to take a pride of its own. So while it can rest and enjoy life, it should. Now they're begging for food now, you see. And Joanne, you say you're glad you're not the only one who would like to cuddle the cubs, but you wouldn't like to be dinner. Well, exactly. And remember, it is very much just a thought experiment. I'm not a fan of any kind of cub or lion petting. I was horrified when some lions are brought around to a school in Johannesburg the other day, like I mentioned. And, you know, it's not a good idea, because we don't know what happens to those cubs once they become much bigger and much more scary. So it is purely a thought experiment. They're all gathering into a little carpet of sleeping cubs, groaning contentedly at each other. And they're just not quite relaxed, because they are little cubs and they like to play. So sweet. And here comes another lioness now from the left-hand side. She also doesn't want to be left out. She wants to be part of the carpet. She just wants some shade, I think. And I think Jamie's still looking for Karula. Let's go and find out how that's going.
We are indeed still looking for those leopards. I just want to stop here. This impala is looking particularly alert. Taxon is still with Tingana and Shadow, although they're still moving about on the southern side of our boundary. And the impala, for a moment, looked incredibly on edge, but I think it's just the windy day that's making them nervous. We're not far away at all from where we last saw Karula. I think it's just rustling leaves and expectant nerves that's making these impala look as uncomfortable as they do. And for good reason, somewhere in there, just to the south of us, the queen is on the hunt, looking to feed herself and her little ones. Knowing her, she is most likely going to be successful at some point over the next few hours. Now, unlike our lions that James is with at the moment, leopards are pretty versatile creatures. Now, moving about in the heat of the day is not something that's going to bother them terribly much, particularly not when there's an empty belly. So Karula could well be hunting throughout between the sunrise and the sunset safari. X-Ranga has not forgotten. Well done, X-Ranga. Jandre and his injuries. And Jandre is quite an accident-prone individual. He's saying no. I think all of the evidence attests to the contrary. Jandre, I think, has paid more visits to the Hoedspruit doctor than the rest of us combined. The last one, of course, was the terrible nail injury, which actually wasn't really his fault, although it could only have happened to Jandre. Oh my goodness, it was awful. Anyway, poor Jandre. We're busy doing the filming behind the scenes, and I was busy doing an elephant dung segment, and as you know, I'm not the tallest of the human beings, and Jandre was not quite happy with my height relative to the vehicle, so he decides he's going to find something for me to stand on. So off he dashes off, like a very eager, eager antelope or something, into the bushes, and returns with a large marula tree, which he then proceeds, I'm not quite sure how he managed it, it was truly special. He managed to drop it on his toe/leg/... How's your toenails? It's still on there. It's hanging in there, but by the skin of its... By the skin, basically, by the sound of it. I asked him how he was. He says he's fine and it's just a little bit of blood and quite possibly a missing toenail. So poor Jandre, once again in the wars. Most unfortunate. Something's happening over here. Let's go and join them and see if Tingana hasn't popped out. So Jandre, I think, will remain in one piece. He's usually quite stoic about the whole thing. I suppose you'd have to be if you're as accident-prone as Jandre is. You have to learn to be stoic. Here we go. Let's go ahead. So there you go, X-Ranger. That is the story of Jandre's toe. And then the marula log that he got for me was so nice of him. But it was the least stable piece of wood I've ever been on. So there's me trying to balance and do this segment. It was hilarious. It looks as though Tingana is now going into the north. Let me just hold on one moment. Morning, Alan. Oh, perfect. Thank you so much. Thanks, guys. How's it? Cheers. He's gone in here somewhere. Well, I think we shall continue our search for Mr. Tingana and his lovely consort, the Shadow, as well as the Queen Karula this afternoon on the Sunset Safari. But for now, it is time for me to say a big farewell and a thank you. So goodbye, everyone. Have a wonderful day. Thank you to Jandre and his broken foot. And we'll catch up with you on the Sunset Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
There's been an enormous amount going on here, Brian. I mean, the cats have, well, twitched slightly, but they're now fighting for shade. Here's Amber Eyes. Hello, Amber, my darling. How are you? Good. Excellent. Nice to see you. Why do you lie on top of your friend there? Why? You don't care, do you? You're not interested in my questions. No. Just go to sleep. She doesn't look very interested, does she, Brian?
Not at all.
No. Deeply disinterested, I would say. Mm. Now, we were chatting about the notable markings, for example. Now, Amber Eyes has got those amber eyes, but she's also got kind of a sort of black mohawk line down her back, which is quite interesting, which is unusual. Now, Honey Ocelot, you say you've just googled lion eye color and you read there that amber is the most common color for eyes in a lion. And then you're wondering if it's just in this particular area that it isn't like that. I think amber is actually is not the correct color to describe her eyes. I think they're orange, and I called her orange eyes originally, but I was corrected by the viewers and they decided to call her amber eyes, because amber eyes is actually a nicer name, really. But if you look at the other eyes, we just got the little ones there, and they're tinged with blue. They are kind of, the other eyes are sort of a yellowy amber color. They're not quite orange, but they are a yellowy amber color. But I would say that no, I'd say they're more honey colored than amber, and in between amber eyes and the normal colored lion's eyes for this area lies the actual color of amber. That's very sweet there. But so I've never seen lions in different areas with different colored eyes. No. Google, of course, a font of great information some of the time, and some of the time, well, it does depend on the interpretation that there is. Susan, you want to know when the lion cub's eyes will go from the sort of deep grey-blue colour to the yellowy amber colour. It will start to happen probably from when they wean, so from about 6 months they'll start to change. There we are, much suckling still to be done. And these little cubs will try and suckle as much as possible before they wean and put on as much condition as they can before they must fight their own time at the kills, which will not be easy. Right, everybody, I'm really quite glad we found these things. I say we, I don't mean we at all, I mean Rexon. So thank you to Rexon, he found the leopards as well, so he's on fire. A big thank you to all of you for joining us on what was a quiet safari for the most part, but great to end it like this. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, James.
That is a lovely Monday morning blues thumb. Yes, very nice. A big thank you to Louise in the final control, with Kirsten McLennan Smithsonian, and of course to Jamie and David on the El Gendre on the other vehicle. We'll see you later during the Sunset Safari.